Effective communication is a hallmark of safe patient care. Challenges to effective interprofessional communication in maternity care include differing professional perspectives on clinical management, steep hierarchies, and a lack of administrative support for change. Effective communication between team members and with their patients is one of the hallmarks of safe and highly reliable patient care. Highly reliable prenatal units, ones that hold patient safety as a central value, have an infrastructure of respect, assertiveness, communication, and competence. System structure alone does not produce high reliability. True high reliability requires individuals and teams to be constantly scanning for defects and correct evolving safety threats, and to adopt to dynamic conditions appropriately. Every team member is accountable for speaking up and stating concerns with persistence until there is a clear resolution. Team members must be clear about the reasoning for specific courses of action and demonstrate openness to input from all team members by soliciting and reflecting on team members' perspectives. Problems with communication and teamwork are well known and a challenge to patient safety in labor and delivery units. It is often tempting to point fingers across professional boundaries, to view communication breakdowns as a nursing problem or a physician problem. However, the sources of communication breakdown in labor and delivery are complex. Physicians and nurses and midwives are equally capable of engaging in both excellent and suboptimal habits and styles of communication. They are equally capable of practicing together, demonstrating a fundamental characteristics of high reliability. Open communication that is respectful, attentive, and collaborative. Likewise, nurses, physicians, and midwives are all equally capable of disrespectful styles of communication, being distracted by personal issues or system problems, and even being self-centered. Thus, the problem of ineffective communication is not a problem of any one profession, but a communal problem for which physicians, nurses, and midwives and institutions need to be accountable. Research has indicated physicians, nurses, and midwives have different views on optimal labor management, suggesting a continual need for communication and negotiation among team members during labor and birth. Yet clinicians persistently express diverse perspectives on the quality of teamwork, communication, and collaboration in their inpatient clinic units. Common reasons for breakdown in understanding include clinicians' failure to communicate their plan and rationale, their failure to communicate concerns effectively, and their efforts to protect patients, themselves or colleagues, from negative consequences of open disagreement. Research that all clinicians, both in labor and delivery and elsewhere, do not voice concerns about patient care or actively avoids clinical conflicts. This occurs for a variety of reasons that may include lack of confidence, saving face and preserving relationships, difference to hierarchy, and fear of repercussions. Interprofessional communications in labor and delivery units highlights chronic communication breakdown that results from different views. One topic is on the benefits of risks oxytocin. Ideally, all clinicians would speak up with confidence, stating what they see and what they think is happening and why they think certain actions should or should not be taken in any patient care situation. This approach may seem obvious when communicating occurs between attending physicians. However, nurses, medical residents, and even attending physicians do not always voice concerns at critical times, or may struggle to do so. Multiple helpful strategies for structuring information transfer between colleagues and among teams are used elsewhere. While several sites have demonstrated safety improvements using packages of teamwork interventions, other sites has demonstrated mixed results. It may not be possible to empirically isolate specific communication strategies as most effective or ineffective. The mixed performance of communication support tools may be due to the fact that communication is a social process constituting much more than simply sending and receiving technical information. Each party in the interactions brings their history, assumptions, and expectations of others with them, and each is influenced by the organizational culture. Because of this, structured tools may not be successful if not embedded in an infrastructure of respect and assertiveness. To this end, I can outline some principles of communication and conflict management that are likely to be helpful, but are not substituted for strategies such as SBAR, board huddles, briefings, and the like. Effective clinical communication is clear, direct, explicit, and respectful. It conveys the level of urgency in the situation, the rationale underlying the requested action, the openness of alternatives to other team members. Excellent listening skills and administration support is required for good communications. Nurses, residents, attending physicians, and midwives must all accept the necessity of persistently pursuing their concerns about patient care until the team determines a clear resolution to the problem. Likewise, all clinicians, but especially those in authoritative positions, must attend to their listening skills. Team leaders should not view inquiry as a challenge to their expertise. They should welcome them as a protective inquiry and assertion, promotion, safety by maintaining preoccupation with potential failure and protecting against the tendency of normalization of deviance that can lead to catastrophic harm. Furthermore, all team members need to ensure they have confirmed agreement on the actions to be taken and the rationale of plan of care. Organizations need to be aligned systems of care to address sleep deprivation and other workforce-related interferences to active listening. Even in the setting of excellent communication skills, nurses, physicians, and midwives may have substantially different views on what constitutes best or safest care. In common obstetric situations such as harnessing versus observation of labor management or induction or augmentation of labor, interpretation and management of complex fetal heart rate patterns, pain management, and second stage management. Thus, clinical conflicts are facts of life and clinicians must learn to deal with them effectively. Many people prefer to avoid confrontation, and nurses in particular have traditionally found ways to sidestep it. However, addressing conflicts as they arise is more likely to build engagement with the trust in team members. Furthermore, addressing potential conflicts early may allow smoother communications later, should an obstetrical emergency arise. Effective communication between physicians and nurses is vital for patient safety. The dynamic environment of labor delivery adds further challenges to effective communication, which may also be thwarted by inattention due to sleep deprivation or shift work and difference. Despite the mutual commitment to provide the best possible care for childbearing women, nursing physicians in labor and delivery may minimize communication, not voicing concerns about patient care, or actually avoid clinical conflict. Reasons for this may include lack of confidence, saving face, preserving relationship, deference to hierarchy, conflict avoidance, and fear of repercussions. Improving communication thus is built on an infrastructure of respect, assertiveness, collaboration, and competence. This foundation includes all of the structural support outlined by others as necessary for prenatal high-velocity liability, but ultimately requires the individual and collective commitment of bedside clinicians to transcend professional stereotypes and flatten traditional hierarchies. Behavior change is hard. We have a mutual responsibility to get it right.